peace in the Middle East. For decades, every president's plan, from Jimmy Carter to Barack Obama, has failed. But why? In his new book, Middle East expert Robert Spencer takes on that question, and his answer will surprise you. Take a look.
For decades, each incoming president has pitched a plan for peace between the Israelis and the Palestinians. All have failed. From Jimmy Carter's Camp David Accord to Bill Clinton's 1993 Oslo Accords, complete with this famous handshake, to calls for a two-state solution by Presidents George W. Bush and Barack Obama.
A Palestinian state that will live side by side in peace with Israel.
Given the demographics west of the Jordan River, the only way for Israel to endure and thrive as a Jewish and democratic state is through the realization of an independent and viable Palestine.
Middle East expert and author Robert Spencer tackles the question of why peace efforts have failed and what can be done about it. In a new book, The Palestinian Delusion, The Catastrophic History of the Middle East Peace Process.
Well, author and Islam expert Robert Spencer joins us now. We welcome him. Nice to see you again.
Great to be here, Pat.
You know,
thank you.
I was reading in the book of Zechariah, and it said that the land will be desolate, and if somebody walks across it, there'll be nobody there. And we understand that, the famous humorist pointed out the fact that he went and looked at the in the early days, and there was nobody living in that land. It was completely empty. Where do those Palestinians come from?
They all came from the surrounding lands, some as far away as Armenia. And you can tell that, actually, from their surnames that often give the indication of where their family is from. And you're right, they're not from that area. I have in the book many other people besides Mark Twain who went through the land and they didn't see anybody there. There were some, there were Jewish populations there all through history, but the idea that this was Arab land has no historical basis.
Well, this whole idea of a Palestine, was that a Roman name, Palestina?
Yes. Actually, you know, it comes from the Philistines.
Philistines.
The Romans expelled the Jews from Judea in the year 134 A.D. after the false Messiah Bar Kokhba and his revolt.
Right.
And so the Romans, to taunt the Jews, renamed the area Palestine, which was a name they got out of the Old Testament, and was derived from Philistine as the Jews' ancient enemy.
So they named it after the enemies of the Jews, the Philistines.
Exactly. Just as a way to rub it in that they were not allowed in that area.
As Mark Twain said, and as we have in the book, there was nobody there until the Jews came in.
That's right. The Arab population actually increased sharply once the Zionist project got going in the late 19th century and Jews started to move in large numbers into that area. Arabs moved there too because the Jews brought economic opportunity and financial stability to the area that had not been there before.
Well, this whole idea of a two-state solution, you know, I talked to Yasser Arafat. I was driving down to meet Arafat one night, and we went by Rachel's tomb, and my driver said, this is a holy site for Islam. And I thought, you're talking about the wife of Israel, and it's a holy site for, you know. And the same thing with the claim of Muhammad to Jerusalem. And you point out that he said he was sleeping and he went to Al-Aqsa, which is the farthest place. Talk about that.
Well, Al-Aqsa means the farthest.
Yes.
And the thing about it is, though, that the Al-Aqsa Mosque on the Temple Mount, which was built as a triumphal mosque to show Islam's victory over Judaism, the Al-Aqsa Mosque wasn't built until 60 years after Muhammad died.
Uh-huh.
And so the idea that he went there is fictional. He meant some other farthest mosque that wasn't actually in Jerusalem at all. Jerusalem is never mentioned in the Quran. It's not really an Islamic holy city at all, except insofar as their claim that it is allows them to dispute the Jewish claim to the land.
Well, they claim he was flying one night. Of course, His wife said, he may have said he took a trip to Jerusalem, but he was lying in bed with
That's
me
right.
all night long.
That's
but
right.
They said his hoof touched down on Jerusalem and then flew off into heaven.
From the Temple Mount.
From
and
the
then
Temple
he
Mount.
Met all the prophets, including Jesus, who's considered a Muslim prophet, and they all hailed him as another prophet. And then he met Allah himself and then came back down and flew back to Mecca, to Medina.
That's fictional nonsense, isn't it?
Yeah, well, of course, it's completely historical fiction. There is no, there's no value, no validity to it at all. It's a story that actually was invented a couple hundred years after Muhammad died.
But they're claiming it. It's their holy site, and they want it as capital of the Palestinian state.
You know, if you go back even 150 years, as you've pointed out about how desolate it was, also, you didn't find Muslims making huge claims to Jerusalem then either and saying that it was a massive, an important Muslim holy site. This kind of thing has only become fashionable since the State of Israel was founded as a stick to beat Israel with.
Well, what is the solution? Our presidents have talked about a two-state solution, and you're saying it can't happen.
No, it could happen, but it would just be another jihad base. They told us that when Israel withdrew from Gaza, that it would become peaceful, and instead it just became a base for more jihad attacks, mm-hmm. as I had predicted. Now, the same thing with if there's a Palestinian state, it would just be another jihad base.
They say that the Jews are descendants of pigs and apes.
Yeah, that's in the Quran.
It's in the Quran.
Three times.
Three times?
Yes, sir.
Pigs and apes.
Yes.
Well, pigs and apes can hardly control a country.
Well, you know, you find it in the rhetoric of jihadis all the time. If you watch Hamas TV or Palestinian Authority TV, you will see them routinely saying, we're dealing with the sons of apes and pigs. And this is something that, if it's not taken literally, although it is by many, it is taken as meaning that we're dealing with moral degenerates who are the worst enemies of the Muslims, as the Quran also says.
So, in terms of global jihad, they will never allow the Jewish state to exist.
Well, that's exactly right, Pat, that there's no, as long as they're believers in Islam, there are going to be some Muslims who think that there's no way that Israel could be legitimate, that it must be destroyed, it's on Muslim land. All these things are based on Islamic teachings. So the only thing Israel can and must do is remain strong in the face of that and lay claim to what it has a right to by international law.
Well, if there's a total jihad going on, then there cannot be a two-state solution.
No, it would just be to diminish and weaken, ultimately to destroy Israel.
That's the only reason.
That's the only thing it would accomplish.
What's wrong with United States foreign policy? Why don't they recognize this?
Because they don't study Islam, because they don't know anything about Islam.
Yeah.
And because if you read the leaders, like you mentioned Arafat and all the others, they all say it's all about Islam. But that's the one thing that our foreign policy establishment has never acknowledged as having anything to do with this.
Well, it's supposed to be gradualism. Little by little by little, we'll take it over. Isn't
that's
it?
The idea.
Yeah. Well, I mean, is Trump part of the delusion? I mean, it goes back to Jimmy Carter and others.
It goes back to Jimmy Carter and goes through Obama, but I don't think Trump shares it because he's the first one to recognize that Jerusalem is Israel's capital and move our embassy there. That was immensely important because remember that it was in the 90s that Congress passed a bill saying that we were going to recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital. But successive presidents set it aside because they were afraid of terrorist attacks.
Yeah.
So the terrorists were setting our foreign policy. And Trump was the first one to stand up and say, no, we're not going to accept violent intimidation. We're going to do what's right.
Why about this jihad? They're moving against al-Sisi in Egypt and others. I mean, the Muslim Brotherhood is still pretty strong, isn't it?
Very strong, absolutely, because it says that we are carrying out what's written in the Quran and Sunnah, and that resonates with many Muslims. So it's not a movement that's just going to pass. As long as they're believers in the Quran, there'll be movements like that.
What are you advising? If you were to sit down and write a paper for an American president, what would you tell him to do?
Well, that's the paper that I wrote for him, and I hope he reads it. But in short, one of the main things, one of the big mistakes that Israel made was to recognize the Palestinian people who don't actually have any historical, ethnic, linguistic, no existence at all. They were made up in the 60s by the KGB and Yasser Arafat, the story is all in the book, in order to become a propaganda point against Israel. Israel needs to roll that back to claim the, its rights to the West Bank and Gaza, as under international law, they're the only state that owns that land, and to call upon Syria, Lebanon, and Jordan to let in, which they don't now, the Palestinian Arabs, who are the same as they are culturally, religiously, mm-hmm. linguistically, everything, and invite them to either be loyal Israeli citizens, or if they're not going to be loyal to the Israeli state, then they can emigrate to one of those other states.
Well, that UNWA is the United Nations Works Agency. They have kept alive this so-called right of return, and they what do they have, about 500,000
Yeah, it's a big joke. I mean, it would be a joke if it weren't so serious.
Yeah.
The problem is that what they do is you can pass on, they pass on refugee status to not just the Palestinians who left the Holy Land in the 1940s, mm-hmm. but to their children, their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren. My grandparents came from the Ottoman Empire. They were exiled for refusing to convert from Christianity to Islam.
Yeah.
And so they were refugees. But my parents were not refugees, and I'm not a refugee. But if we were Palestinians, I'd be a refugee.
Is that the way it is?
It's absolutely ridiculous.
Well, shouldn't we cut off funding? I think Trump's trying to cut off funding for that organization.
He's cut it off, and that's another great thing that he's done. He's cut through all the foreign policy establishment nonsense.
Well, how about the Golan? I mean, he's you know, that's a place of contention, and he said it belongs to Israel now.
And he was right. Because, you know, throughout human history, Pat, when an aggressor nation attacks another nation and loses, mm-hmm. they lose territory. And it's a matter of the national security of the nation that was victorious and was attacked in the first place. This has been recognized all over the globe for century after century, except in the case of Israel. But Israel, I'm sure you've been as well, but I've been to by Lake Tiberias,
yes.
and you look up at the Golan Heights, and I've been in the Golan Heights also. But the Syrians used to stand on the Golan Heights and shoot down at Israeli
exactly.
farms. And now it's a thriving area. Israel needs the Golan for its own protection.
Well, it's a dilemma. I don't know. I just don't know if there are people in the State Department that understand what it is, because there's been tremendous opposition against Trump. And there was this fear of the Muslims. I mean, should we be afraid of Islam, or should we deal with it as a hostile power?
We have to recognize what it's all about.
Uh-huh.
And then deal with it realistically. Fear is ultimately counterproductive. What we need is a realistic assessment of what it is. Right now in the State Department, and the Palestinian problem is a quintessential example of this, we have fantasy-based policymaking
yes.
that it doesn't have anything to do with reality. And the primary aspect of that is that our approach to this conflict does not recognize the Islamic imperatives that the Palestinians are working from.
One last thing. You pointed out that Muhammad didn't hesitate to lie when he was dealing with people. And is that part of Islamic statecraft?
Oh, yes, sir. That's the Treaty of Hudaybiyah,
yeah.
which was a treaty Muhammad concluded. And it mandates that you can break the treaty when you no longer need it. And that's what Muhammad did. And so it is the pattern of all Islamic treaty making. When Yasser Arafat concluded the Oslo agreements, mm-hmm. he went back and people were angry with him because it was unfavorable. And he said, don't worry, this is like Hudaybiyah. In other words, we're going to use it as far as we can for our own advantage and break it when we don't need it anymore.
Hudaybiyah. And that's the pillar of their negotiating posture.
Yes, sir. If you look in Islamic law, they'll say the Treaty of Hudaybiyah is the example we must follow to make treaties, and it was a disadvantageous treaty for the Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
But we only entered into it because we needed it at the time for protection, and then when we built up our strength, we break it. We broke it, and that's what we can do in any case with treaties.
Is the nation of Israel ever going to be able to make a deal with the Palestinians? You know, they used to be under Jordanian law. Maybe wouldn't that be better if they were Jordanian citizens?
Well, they're Jordanians. They're exactly the same people. And so, yes, the Jordanians should take them in. There's already a Palestinian state. It's Jordan, as
yeah.
well as the Syrians, the Lebanese. It's all the same people. the Arabs of the region. But no, there's no agreement that Israel's going to be able to make with the Palestinians that would ensure Israel's survival as a Jewish state.
All right.
Only one that would make be a step toward destroying it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Palestinian delusion. I wish those in the State Department at, quote, Foggy Bottom would read this and begin to order our foreign policy in accordance. Robert, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. Pleasure.
Pleasure. God bless you.